iterator that is backed by a collection. So because the iterator has a special access to the underlying structure of the collection, like for example, if you're iterating through a hash set that internally organizes the elements in a hash table, so now the iterator, so because it's been defined as an inner class of hash table. We'll talk about those next week when we talk about swing. So it does have access to the underlying, even the private parts of the hash set, and then it can intelligently go to the next element from the current one. But from the outside, so as long as the iterator has the objects next and has next, so we don't know and we don't care what kind of entity is generating the elements for the iterator. And the same idea as with the Python lazy sequences is that we can implement these methods to produce even an infinite sequence lazily in a purely computational fashion. So now of course there cannot be a remove method or anything similar. But here is a lazy iterator for the infinite Fibonacci sequence. So maintain enough state, all these computational iterators must have enough state that they can always produce the next value. They have enough information for that one. And for the Fibonacci numbers, we just need to store not the entire sequence. Some other problems would require that, but the Fibonacci, just the previous two. And now, so starting with the 0 and 1, so then because this logic here could be written many ways, but so now we are one behind. So has next, that one is easy. So this is an infinite sequence. There's always a next element. Notice how we are now producing big integer values because these Fibonacci numbers, they grow up so quickly that that otherwise there's no point. So the next one, so then add the previous two values, throw away the oldest one. And then the second oldest is returned. So the Fibonacci demo here, and also showing that once you have a iterator, so you can give it to a decorator immediately, so then you get the decorated version of that one. So this one would duplicate each Fibonacci number twice, so then we would get the 25 first Fibonacci numbers, each one duplicated twice. So what is iterators, as we can see, so this is the closest thing that the Java, at least that the Java 8 has to the Python generators and such. But let's move on to the next important theory topic that's gonna be important when we talk about the swing. So this idea from Python that code and data, so functions and what we think of as different things, they're actually the same thing. So just like every string and an integer is an object that you can pass to a function and receive as a result, so functions are also objects in Python. You can write the function that receives a function as a parameter, then internally uses it for its own purposes, and you could even write the function that creates and returns a new function that then the others can use. So this is the spirit of functional programming, one of the many things there, but so is that we don't make this artificial distinction between code and data. But Java, coming from the imperative programming background, so its roots, the spirit in there is that the code and data, they're two completely separate things and never the twain shall meet. So once the code has been compiled, so then it cannot modify itself during the runtime. So in Java, there simply are no bytecode instructions that could modify the bytecode instructions. You cannot write the self-modifying program in Java, at least without some very underhanded tricks. But the bytecode instructions that the Java programs compile to, they modify the contents of the stack and the heap. So instructions modify your local variables and the state of your objects. But Java, we can trace the development of the versions, we'll talk about this at the end of the course, shifting to the more functional programming spirit. So back when I was a student, so I remember we were taught that the functional and imperative, that they are two separate things, but I think the reality is more of a continuum there. So the languages fall in a different place in the continuum based on how many functional programming features they include. And the development of Java has been steady shifting of the language more to the functional programming direction. So now, what is the optimum, where's the sweet spot in this continuum? Well, Python 3 feels in practice like it's a very sweet spot. So the languages that are purely functional, then those are so weird and so strange that few people can use them productively. And then the very low-level imperative languages, the difference between Java and Python almost. But so what is the sweet spot that the languages try to find? So because we realize that sometimes it's a good idea to be able to use code as data. Like for example, when sorting, if you just sort, so then the sorting is done with respect to the native order comparison of the element type. You sort integers, you get them in the magnitude and order, and you sort strings, you get them in the lexicographic dictionary order. But what if you wanna sort some other order? So you might have some custom sorting criteria. So Python, the sort function can be given a key function as an optional argument. So sort each element as if it had been the key function produces from that element. And Python, that's especially convenient because your key function can return a tuple, and the tuple comparison in Python is lexicographic, so you return a tuple of the primary, secondary, and so many sorting criteria, and then you get the multi-criteria sorting for free. So this kind of thing is so nice that we wanna be using it also in Java, but the thing is methods and code, they're not the first class citizens of Java. You cannot write the method that receives a method as an argument. You can write the method that receives a string or an iterator or a bank account. Those are data, those are objects, but you cannot write the method that receives a method or a method that creates a new method and returns it. So code is set in stone. We cannot do that. But now to satisfy the letter of this law, because we do want the ability to pass methods as arguments. So this pattern that is demonstrated here, writing our custom comparator, but again, so understand how strategy objects work, so then you'll understand how they work in every context. So because we cannot pass a method compare as an object of its own. Like in a Python, we can pass an arbitrary function as an object of its own. So we kind of give, to follow the letter of the law, so we gift wrap our method inside an object. So Java interfaces allow us to do this in a totally type-safe fashion at the compile time. So this concept, so let's look at the comparator interface. The interface promises to have object, promises to have a method. So theoretically, if you wanna pass multiple methods to a function, to another method, then you could theoretically pack them all into the same object, but just like a Christmas present, so every present is separately wrapped. So then they can be handled separately, and then you don't need to give them all at the same time. So that's just a good design. So this idea of a functional interface, an interface that contains one method. I'm looking at Java 7 documentation because Java 8 brought a whole bunch of stuff in here that I don't want to talk about until the end of the course. But so the idea of a functional interface, an interface that defines one method, so an arbitrary comparator of elements. Python sorting, remember, uses the key function, so a function that takes one parameter and sort as if there had been the result of the key. But Java uses, Python actually used this in the early versions, but then they switch the idea that the comparator is an arbitrary method that receives the two elements to compare, and then again with the positive, negative, or zero result indicates what is the mutual ordering of these two values. So comparator, again generic class, what kind of elements it is comparing. So let's as an example write a wacky comparator of integers. So the odd even comparator, we just make up a rule. So this is mathematically legit. So this is a total ordering. It just looks kind of weird because it puts the integers in two infinite open-ended rows. We say that all the odd numbers, regardless of the sign and magnitude, are less than any even number, and otherwise, so odds and odds are compared normal way, and evens compared normal way. When you're writing a comparator, so make sure that it's total. That for unless the two objects are equals, then this is supposed to make a distinction. So get a return either plus one or minus one. So compare. Now we're using the wrappers here, so int and integers, don't mind that for a moment. You cannot use a primitive type as a generic type argument. We can use the wrapper, but as we'll talk in a couple of weeks, so the autoboxing, the automatic conversion between primitives and wrappers, so we don't even notice that there is anything hinky going on. So method that compares two integers. So if one is odd and other one is even, I realized that I could cache the parities of A and B instead of, doesn't make much difference here. So then the oddness decides, and otherwise if both have the same parity, so then we just do the ordinary integer comparison. Here is, by the way, some people try to use a trick as a one-liner arithmetic. This would work in Python, but not in Java. Return the difference of the two integers. Well, this works fine as long as these integers are small, but remember, integer data type has a fixed size. So when A is sufficiently large positive number and B is a sufficiently small negative number, this difference doesn't fit into an int variable anymore, and you get an overflow. So that trick works in Python because integers cannot overflow, but in Java this is the proper way to do it. Another one, so let's here is a lexicographic comparison. So compare the strings as if they were in a dictionary. So we already have a string dictionary comparison, so let's force both to the strings. This looks a bit silly, concatenating with the empty string forces the conversion to a string. And then this is now the strings internal compare to method that we use to compare the integers. And comparator, so especially these strategy objects, because there's only one method. So decorator, while writing a decorator, as you can see, is very painless. So we can make a decorator that can convert any comparator into a comparator that works the same way, but in addition, so on the side, maintains a count of how many times the comparator has been called. So the decorator, when it's consulting the underlying comparator to do the hard work, it just before that increments the count of comparisons. And then, so whenever you're making a subclass, so when you implement the interface, you have to have the methods that you promise, but then of course you're allowed to have other methods that are appropriate for the concept. And to finish up this video now, so let's demonstrate the comparators. This method, let's run it here in blue JSON. We can see, so the method creates an array list of 10 random numbers, random integers, and 10 collection sort without the comparator object using the native order comparison of integers. But then when we use the odd even comparator, so the sort method has been overloaded, you can give the comparator as the second argument. So now we have all the odd numbers first in their own, so ordinary order, followed by all the even numbers in order. So any even number is greater than any odd number. Sounds a bit wacky, but it's mathematically perfectly legal. And furthermore, because we also decorate the counting comparator, costs us nothing to do so. then we can ask so to sort the 10 elements. The sorting algorithm used internally performed the 23 element comparisons along the way. And sorting in the dictionary order, so take these numbers and just pass another custom comparator strategy object. So in the dictionary order, so all the numbers that start with 1, all the numbers that start with 6, that start with 7 and start with 9. So the decorator, no sorry, the strategy object is a handy nice way to offer a tinkering of the internals of some particular method, and this is gonna be heavily used in swing. So in the next week's lecture, we're gonna be seeing these strategy objects all over the place.